The first way digital history let me do something that traditional scholarship didn't allow me to do was doing quantitative analysis of large amounts of data. That doing it by hand was just virtually impossible, but having the computer do the statistical analysis made it possible in ways that you couldn't do if you were just counting and looking. So that's kind of digital history, and but that's an old kind of digital history that's been around for a long time. Other kinds of digital history, in some ways it involves very simple things like students. JSTOR as a kind of digital history is fascinating to me because students who knew to look in history journals now, because of how they search in JSTOR, suddenly realize that, oh, the topics that we're talking about in history, geographers were doing and sociologists were doing. And so that helps construct another kind of digital history that would never have been done. Certainly for teaching, having resources like the Valley of the Shadow or the New York Times and so on opens up the ability to do research to an enormous number of people that didn't do it before. Ancestry.com, I think, is one of those great examples of, it's amazing to me how many people now just work with the census day in and day out and then create their own history through roots webs and things like that, which turn around and end up being very useful to us as historians. It lets me teach with sounds and images in an easier way. I think the hardest part for me that is still unanswered is how do we now turn around and present interpretive history using the web? I think we spend a lot of time teaching graduate students how to write history. We teach people from the time they're little how to read history, how to read a book and everything else, but trying to understand how to take advantage of this new digital environment where we can now find all kinds of things and have opened up the past, visualized the past in a lot of different ways and so on, is now how do we use that to let us as historians now tell that kind of interpretive history that is what has kind of defined us in the past. The number of people who read many of our monographs is very small, although you know, the number of people who watch History Channel is even bigger. I think part of how big that audience is depends on how much publicly available search engines make this available. It's one of those things that that I find interesting that, for example, for the electronic encyclopedia, the fact that Google finds things makes, and that was one of our decisions, makes it more immediately available. I mean, it puts it kind of on the same plane with Wiki in terms of things. So my entry on Pullman is going to be read by so many more people than either read the print encyclopedia or certainly will ever read the book. It also, one of the things I think finds interesting is though how do we then start to think about where our scholarship as professional historians fits in with other kind of scholarship. I mean, you can see this in books in terms of who publishes the most successful histories and so on. But my students now go first to Google. That's where they expect to find everything, and you know, trying to switch them into databases that aren't available on Google is often very difficult. So I think our challenge is, even if we do digital history, how to get it easily available to people so that it's so it really is available instead of putting it out and you know a handful of people know about it, kind of the people who normally would read our books anyway, how to make it available to the public. I think the Newberry's influence was profound in a lot of very interesting ways. When the Newberry got into digital history, as it were, it was in that era of new social and new political history, and it provided a place, both through its summer institutes and then its mini institutes around the country, that introduced any number of historians, literally hundreds of historians, into using data online, using quantitative techniques, to being familiar with computers, getting over that kind of initial block. I remember when one of the first KPROs came out, Richard Jensen insisted that we have this microcomputer there so that people could use it and experiment with it and so on. And I think the Newberry's impact there was very profound in helping a whole generation of people who were doing cutting edge social history and political history and a whole women's history and a whole variety of histories to start to think about how this new technology was used. And what is of interest to me, even when you look at the people who talk here today, how many people have come out of that quantitative tradition to think about using history for GIS, or using digital equipment and computers for doing GIS, for doing all kinds of representations, where they really kind of cut their teeth on that early training that was provided at the Newberry. Then I think even beyond that, the Newberry has, I mean, the fact that it took on the Encyclopedia of Chicago and was willing to think about this as a digital project and everything else, even if it brought in the University, or the Chicago Historical Society and Northwestern and so on to help realize it, gives a sense of how much it's still interested in really taking some risks on these kinds of things. So I think as an institution, it's been very important in the, you know, since the mid-70s when it started being involved in these projects. And I think one of the things we need to come to grips with, and I don't think it's just history with this, but reflects some of the conversations at lunch, which is how do we teach in a digital age? You know, my students have different expectations about where they're going to find material, how they're going to read material, and so on. So I think we have to come to grips with that kind of question. And then we have to think about, and this is one of the places where your program and the program at Virginia and several others are great, which is how do you teach a whole generation of the new historians to be not even ahead of the curve, but to be caught up with where the rest of the world is going. I mean, I have some of my colleagues who say, I know this is changing things, but fortunately I'm going to retire before I have to really have to grapple with it. And I think, I don't say that in a kind of negative way. I think they recognize what the situation is, and they also recognize what the learning curve is. When you think about, and you who are involved in a program like this have an excellent sense of this, how does one start to measure the priorities? I mean, I've reached my limit on what I can do with HTML and what I, if I'm going to do this myself, I'm going to have to learn a whole lot more about technology. And if not, we have to change the way, I mean, if I don't do it, then we have to work in kind of design teams that are very different from the ones that we traditionally do teaching or to write and so on. And what does it mean for scholarship, for all kinds of things, to have this new kind of organization of doing our work? So it's your generation and new graduate students who are going to really have to grapple with that.